Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's lift up the name of Jesus. This is the day he has made, and we're going to will it in our spirit this morning and give him the praise, the honor, and the glory. Hallelujah. Lift up the name of Jesus right now, right where you are, whether you're in your home, you're in your cars, wherever you are, God is worthy to be praised. Do you have breath in your lungs that you can breathe this morning? Do you have hands that you can wave? Do you have a head that you can just rock from side to side, a body that can move? The Bible said, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. And if God has been good to you, if God has allowed you to see another day, the first thing that should come out of your mouth is, thank you, Lord. Thank you for waking me up. Thank you for starting me on my way. Thank you for giving me the fresh new day where I can give you the glory and the praise, where I can understand that I'm an image bearer, where my life can reflect your glory. Today is a day for praise. Today is a day for adoration. For today is a day to lift up and magnify the King. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us rejoice in him together. Let's rejoice in his powerful and matchless name. Oh, my soul will make its boast in the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, the ruler of all that is living. We thank God for the opportunity to come onto this broadcast today to lift up the name of names, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, that is Jesus the Christ. I greet you in Jesus' name. This is the Reflections Church Sunday service online. My name is Pastor Louis Straker. I am the lead pastor here at Reflections, and it is an honor and a privilege to be with you this morning. We are here live virtually as we are lifting up the name of Jesus via social media and technology and online, as we are in the midst of a pandemic, and the church is actually dispersed right now, but the church keeps on going. The doors of this building may be closed, but the church keeps on going. And I want the church to just magnify their King today. It doesn't matter where you are, the place where you call upon the name of the Lord becomes a sanctuary. So I want you to just begin to worship him. I want you to begin to magnify him. I want you to begin to just lift him up. And you don't have to wait till you're back in church to lose your mind. You can lose your mind wherever you are when you set your mind on Jesus. Because when you set your mind on the wonderful things that he has done, you ought to lose the mind that you have for the world, the troubles and the cares that you have. And people may think like you're losing your mind, but what you're having is it's almost like an out-of-body experience, because you understand that you are with him in heavenly places. And when you set your mind on things above, it now brings about a reality that this world cannot comprehend. So when you praise him today, don't praise him from the earthly perspective. I want you to praise him when you see him high and lifted up. I want you to join in with the heavenly host as we lift up the name of the King and magnify him as they sit around the throne and they fly around the throne and they cry out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Don't give him an earthly praise today. Give him a heavenly praise today. For we are only practicing for the big praise session that will happen continually around the throne. And so if you expect to go there someday, why don't you perfect your praise down here? Why don't you perfect it while you're in your home? Perfect it while you're in your car? Perfect it while you're walking by the wayside? Wherever you go, perfect your praise today. Say, this is the kind of praise that I'm going to have in glory. And the more you perfect it here, the more you're going to be prepared for up there. We're just traveling through this earth. We're traveling. We're on a journey. We're passing through. We're pilgrims. We're strangers to this land. This is not our home, but we're praising for our reality. We're praising for that which is to come. And so I dare you and I challenge you to give God the praise and the glory in advance. We are nearing home, ladies and gentlemen. We are nearing home. This world cannot last much longer, but God is going to get the glory and God is going to get the praise. And I want you to just take a moment right now and begin to lift him up and magnify him. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Well, once again, I greet you in Jesus' name, Pastor Louis Straker Jr., lead pastor here at the Reflections Church. The honor and privilege is mine to host you for our Sunday worship service. Whether you are visiting by family member or friend that invited you, or someone shared the broadcast and you were able to stumble across it, I believe that God has a word just for you today. I always say there's no accidents. You came on this broadcast, you stumbled by it, and God wants to speak to your heart today. I believe that God always has a word. There is it. No, this is the power of the anointing. One message has the ability to touch the hearts of so many people. One message has the ability to speak to thousands, yea, millions of people. That is the power and the anointing of God. And I pray that it rest upon you today as you receive the Rhema word, that God will begin to speak to your heart and speak to your mind today, and that you would see him high and lifted up. So we greet all of our visitors, those that are visiting with us via streaming and online, or Facebook, or where have you. We thank God for this wonderful opportunity to lift up his name and for you to join in the praises with us. And so we declare that God is great. He's greater than anything that's happening in this world, greater than any situation, greater than any problem. And so we come to lift him up, and we invite you to lift him up with us as well. And so we greet you from all over the globe. We greet you from Africa. We greet you from Europe. We greet you from Asia. We greet you from South America. We greet you from here in North America. We greet you from Central America. We greet you from the Caribbean. God bless each and every one of you. We thank God for your presence. Today we're going to have a powerful day in the things of God. We have an opportunity to partake of the Lord's Supper today. I don't know if you have any elements around, get some grape juice, get a wafer or something, and you can participate today. But we are going to celebrate what the Lord has done for us that allows us to be a part of the body of Christ. And I thank God for these times of reminders and refreshing in the communion experience with God. And so we praise God. We thank God for his grace and his mercy. To all my partners in ministry at the Reflections Church, God bless you. So good to be with you yesterday as we gathered together on our monthly Zoom call. And it was good to see your faces. It's good to see that we're growing, we're developing. God is doing something fresh. God is doing something new here at Reflections. And if you don't have a home church, I invite you to get on board and connect with us. God is doing something awesome and powerful through this ministry. And so we thank you for stopping in. If you don't mind, man, hit the like button, hit the love button. Let us know you're there. If you're visiting, let us know where you're visiting from. All my partners, hit the like button, hit the love button. Share this broadcast. You never know who needs to hear the word today. And we will give God the glory and the praise that is due to his holy name. And so I invite you now as we enter into worship and we begin to lift up the name of Jesus, I invite you now to enter in with a heart of prayer, a heart of prostrate to give God what he deserves, his holy worship. We come to magnify his name, and let us do it together. I'll be right back after our praise and worship segment. I'll be back with the word for today. God bless you. See you soon.
Father God, we ask that you come into our situations, God. turn things around, God. Give us spiritual eyesight, God. No matter what we're going through, Father, we're going to praise your name. We're going to lift you up. We're going to bless you, God. We're going to claim the victory, Father. And we're going to trust you, God. Thank you, God, for always being there. Thank you, Father God, for loving us the way that you do. God, we just ask right now, as we go forth, God, put a testimony on our lips, a story in our heart, God, so that, Father God, as people look at our lives, they don't see us, but they see Jesus working in us. And so, Father, we thank you. We bless you. We lift your name up, God. We shout hallelujah to the Most High God. Oh, may your name be praised forever. We ask all of these things in the name of Jesus we pray. And let all the people say amen and amen. Come on and bless his name today.
There's
no one like you are.
You are.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God, my God, just lift your hands right where you are and just take a few more seconds and give him the glory. Take a few more seconds and give him the praise. There's no God like our God. Hallelujah. Sometimes all you can say that is God, my God. He's your God today. Let him be your ruler. Let him be your king. Let him be your master. God, my God, you are my prince. You are my peace. You are my everything. You need to hold on to God today with everything that you have, because he's the only one that can give you peace in the midst of the storm. Just begin to cry out and lift your hands. God, my God, I need you in this hour. I need you in this moment. I need you. Lord, I need you every hour. I need you. Oh, bless us now, our Savior. We come to you in humble hearts. We come to you saying, God, we need you more than ever. In a world that's full of chaos, in a world that's full of confusion, in the midst of a pandemic, we say we need you. God, my God, show yourself mighty. Show yourself strong. Speak to your people today and set them free. For your word is freedom. For your truth is freedom. And those who have heard the truth has set them free today. I thank you, God, that the word will come forward with boldness, with clarity, and set the captive free. We bind up the hand of the enemy. We bind up fear, doubt, and confusion. We bind up technical difficulties. We bind up anything that will come to distract and to deter the people of God that need to hear your word this morning. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to speak on your behalf. Hide me behind your cross. Hide me behind your throne, God, and let your word speak out. We thank you, God, that you will speak and your servants will hear and be doers. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everybody say amen and amen. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. God is worthy to be praised. What do you say? Hallelujah. We thank God for the opportunity to be with you here today once again. My name is Pastor Louis Straker, Jr. I am the lead pastor here at the Reflections Church. physically located at 1078 Utica Avenue in Brooklyn, New York, but we are virtual 100% as we are in the midst of this pandemic and still taking all necessary precautions. But we thank God for technology that allows us to come in and to now to enter into your homes, to enter into your mobile devices and saturate it with the presence and the word of God. And so today, people are all over the world. People all over the world are lifting up the name of Jesus, not just in physical spaces, but all over the world in virtual spaces. And we join in with the praises of God's people, and we pray God's favor upon every broadcast that is streaming today, that God will be lifted up and that hearts will be drawn closer to him. And so we greet you. We thank God for those of you that are visiting here with us, all of our partners in ministry. God bless you once again. It's good to be with you all as we continue to lift up the name that is above all names. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is King of Kings and he is Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Well, as I told you earlier, we'll be partaking of the Lord's Supper today. And so I want to give a brief word today. I'd like to be brief on communion so we can spend the time in the memorial of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so I have one text today, and we will look from the Gospel according to John. John, the 16th chapter, and the 32nd verse. We'll read verse 32 and 33. John, the 16th chapter, verses 32 to 33. Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come. When you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word. I want to use as a title in part 7 of the From the Heart series, today I want to use a title, Take Heart. Take heart. Come on, tell somebody he's talking about and he's trying to tell you that you need to take heart. Don't let anybody take your heart. You need to take heart. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Those of you that been around my ministry a while, you know that I love my urban classics. And one of the urban classics, you know, I told you before, I don't watch a lot of new stuff. If I find something I like, I watch it over and over again just for the enjoyment of it. I don't like to experiment too much, but there's some urban classics that always are staples that if they're on, I'm going to, you know, if I can find the time, I'm going to take the time to watch it. And so one of them is the urban classic called Baby Boy. Some of you might remember Baby Boy with Tyrese and Taraji Henson and some classic lines in there. And so there's a scene in there that is quite apropos to our message for today and this series, as Jody, a young fella who struggling with levels of maturity, you can see he has a young lady. In fact, he has about two kids and two different baby mamas, and they call him Baby Boy because he hasn't really developed yet. He's still living at home with mama. His girl has a car, but he rides a bicycle, and he, you know, takes the car and he does some stuff to it, and he does little things in order to get himself going. But it seems like Jody has struggles. Maybe there was the absentee of a father to really teach him how to be a man. And he seems to be a mama's boy. And other men have been dating his mom. And if you know the movie, you know, you know the background. Well, there's a scene where Jody, who is, I don't know, somewhere in maybe mid-20s, late-20s, he gets jumped by what appears to be some high school students, some little guys that are out there, some little thugs, and he gets jumped, and some guys try to take his bike, and Jody's boy hears about it as Jody runs home, and he tells him, "Yo, I got jumped. And he said, "By who jumped my man?" He said, some little, I can't say the word on TV, some little, and he said, "Some little, we need to go. You can't get jumped by some little. You need to go and get, we need to handle this." And so they get out there, and they get in their car, and they go out, and they actually find these guys hanging out in the park. And so they catch up with them, and so the older guy, his boy, rolls up on them, and he acts like he's drunk, and he's rolling around, and they, you know, the little kids hanging out, little guys, just hanging out, they're causing trouble, but they're just hanging out at the end of the day, and he stumbles upon him, and they find these guys. Some of y'all remember the scene. And so, of course, you know, they pull out a gun and those kinds of things. Don't mind me. Don't judge me. You know, it's the movies today, you know, stuff that I grew up on. All right, so here we go. We're talking about baby boy, and he pulls it out on them, and they come to get revenge for a jumping little old Jody. And so he lines them up. He lines them up. He said, which one of these been messing with you, Jody? And he lines them up. He said, "Yeah, this little one right here, you know, he tried to take my bike." And so his boy, you know, he cop back, both of them cop back, and he punched the guy in the face. Well, first Jody punched, and then the guy, and he feeling all the pain. And then his boy said, "Man, you know, that's not how you hit a guy. That's not how you hit. When you hit, see, you're hurting your hand because you're hitting off the side and the bone. You got to know how to hit in the sweet spot. You got to know how to catch him right around here in the soft part of the nose where you get him good. And when you get him good, you know, they're going to knock down, and then it won't hurt your hand so much. So you do it like this." And he cop back, and he got one, and then he got the other, and then got to the other one, and the other one was flinching. He said, "No, don't flinch. If you were so hard to jump my homeboy, if you were so hard to do all of this stuff, don't flinch now when you have to get yours. So just make sure that you stand firm. Don't flinch. And then he caught him, and another one got up. He caught him again. And then it comes to the last one. And this last one relates to my message today, because this last one stands there, which seemed to be the ringleader, which probably was the oldest of these young thugs. And when it was time for Jody's boy to knock this one out, he was the last one standing. He said, "Now stand still. And so young man stood still, and he raised his chin. He raised his chin up, and he looked at him when he was about to strike him. He said, oh, this little, he got heart. He got heart. Oh, you got heart? You got heart?" And he said, "Yeah, you know, I got heart." He said, "Oh, yeah, this little one here, he got heart. He got heart, Jody. He got heart." He said, "You know what? I'm gonna knock you out because you got heart." Then he took off his belt and started to whoop him. And so, you know, it don't matter how much heart you got, a whooping will take you back psychologically and put you in places where you just feel totally defeated, greater than a punch. But there was something about that scene there where that young man chinned up, and they realized that he wasn't scared. He wasn't scared. He wasn't afraid to deal with the consequences of his actions. He was ready to chin up, and he was ready to take whatever comes his way like a true G. And so there's something to be said about being able to chin up and face the obstacles or whatever it is that's coming your way in life. And so he said, "Oh, this little guy, he got heart.
He got heart. And because he got heart, I see something inside of him. I see something that's worthy of acknowledging it. And when we talk about the heart, as we've been talking here in our series, we understand that the heart speaks of a man's character. It speaks of his ability to either withstand or to fall due to the circumstances that comes his way. And so I started talking about this even in Wednesday night in Bible study, as I was talking about the kingdom of God and the Lord God reigning inside of our hearts. And a lot of times when we talk about heart, we tend to talk about it from our feelings or our emotions. You know, this is how I feel in my heart and this and that. But really, when you're talking about the heart, especially from a biblical perspective, which is beyond emotions that allow you to move based upon your gut feelings, and you do things based upon your heart, and sometimes you feel it and sometimes you don't. But when it comes to biblical understanding of heart, in Hebraic terms, the heart metaphorically speaks to a person's inner life. And so it speaks of the will, the thoughts, the motivations, the emotions, which really speaks about a man's soul. And so it speaks of the mind, the will, and the emotions. It speaks of the very things that the heart is the seedbed of. And so no matter what is going on in life, you've got to take control of your heart. I'm going to say that again. No matter what is going on around you in life, you've got to learn to take control of your heart. It is the seedbed of your mind, your will, and your emotions. In other words, it is the seedbed of how you think, how you act, and how you feel. And so this is critically important, ladies and gentlemen, as many a man has fallen because of the failure to take control of his heart. Too often people, they feel first, and then they act secondly, and then they think lastly. And so this, when you begin to see that pattern of behavior, it is a sign of immaturity, because you are allowing your emotions to dictate your actions, and then after your actions, then you want to think about it. But sometimes thinking about it can be too late. See, there's a lot of people that are sitting in prison that did not know how to control their emotions. There are a lot of people that are strung out on drugs because they did not know how to control their emotions. There are a lot of people that have ended up in dark places in life because they did not know how to handle their emotions. And so the human brain does not develop until the age range of 25 to 30. And so that's what behavioral science and scientific research has shown. That's why I always encourage people to, if you're going to make life decisions, let's make it within that age range or after, because your mind is still developing. You're 20 years old, 21, 22, you may be growing, you may be moving into somewhat of an adult life, but you're still wet behind the ears and breath smelling like Similac. There's still some things that you need to learn you haven't fully developed yet. And so the scientific research shows that between the ages of 25 to 30 is where that brain really gets to its full development. And much of this development is also shaped by education and healthy experiences that promotes mature thinking. And so this is why it's important that you continue to feed your mind. You continue to see people that matriculate in educational pursuits and career pursuits and really about their business, have a better, a more solid mind than those that are just living for the weekend, just living for entertainment, just living to do whatever. And so this is important to the developmental process of the brain, because when you are mature, then you think right. If you are immature, then your thinking is going to be off. It doesn't matter how much you believe what you feel you believe. Most of your belief is based upon your feelings. Most of your belief is based upon your emotions. And so however you feel, you think that that's how it is. And then what happens is, without the ability to think maturely, we let our emotions dictate our actions. And then what happens is, after we let our emotions, our feelings dictate our actions, and then what happens, we think about the consequences later. And unfortunately, many people end up later on thinking about the things that they did in the past that they can't undo, and they have to suffer the consequences of poor decisions, but the decisions weren't based upon sound logic and reason. It was based upon your emotional response to a thing. So you feel, and then you act, and then you end up thinking. However, the mature mind, it thinks first. It has the ability to think about the consequences of their actions before they go out and act. So the mind thinks first, and then a mature mind, it acts secondly, and then it informs itself on how to feel about it. Thus my mind has to control my attitude, and my attitude will control my behavior, and my behavior will direct how I feel. This is why how you carry yourself and the things that you do makes you feel a certain way. If you're acting out negative, you're going to feel negative. This is why exercise is so important. They tell you after you get into the regimen of exercising, that behavior has a psychological effect on how you feel. And so behavior has a way of dictating your emotions. But if you do it in reverse, you end up thinking about, what did I just do? But if you do it in the proper way, in the mature way, you think first, you act second, and after you act, now your behavior now dictates how you feel about it. And so you've got to make up in your mind, ladies and gentlemen, that no matter what punches life throws at you, you're going to keep your chin up and don't flinch. Come on, tell somebody, don't you flinch. Come on, tell somebody, don't flinch. Get your chin up. Get your chin up. Why? Because you're called to have heart. Listen, in this season and in this life, the Bible calls for you to have heart. When you look at the scriptures and you see the word that the psalmist writes in 27 and 14, while his enemies is coming in against him, he says, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait on the Lord. Don't you panic like God is not in control. Don't you panic like he's not seeing what's going on and he will not come through. You got to learn, as he says again in Psalms 31 and 24, he says, be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. For those of you who put your faith in God, for those of you who know who God is, you got to learn how to trust him and just wait on him. He may not come when you want him, but I want you to know he'll be right on time. And you got to learn how to stand in the midst of the storm and say that my God will come and meet me when he sees fit. I may not be able to quench the fire, but I know that I serve a God who has the ability to step in the midst of the fire, and it will not consume me. It will not burn me. I don't have to give in to my circumstances. I don't have to give in to my emotions. I don't have to give in to my feelings, but I know that I know that I know that I can take heart, because he that watches over Israel, he never sleeps, he never slumbers. This is the kind of God that we serve, and I challenge you today to take heart. He tells them, Matthew 9 and 22, you remember the story with the woman of the issue of blood who made her way through the crowd. She made her way to Jesus, even though it was a situation where she should have been considered an outcast and not in the midst of the community because she was unclean. And unfortunately, she was bleeding for 12 years. And she came to the area where she heard there was a man that can heal. And all she wanted to do was just get a touch of the hem of his garment. And when she touched the hem of his garment, virtue came out of the body of Christ. And when he felt that, he said, "Who touched me? I felt something come out of me. I know we're in the crowd, but somebody was able to now have the courage to touch me and pull something from me." Do you have the courage today to be able to make your way through the crowd of life and begin to pull on the garment of Jesus and say, "Lord, I need a touch from the Master's hand. If I could just touch the hem of this garment, I know that I would be made whole." And when Jesus got a hold of this woman, the first thing he tells her is, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly, the Bible says, because she was able to take heart, because she was able to stand courageous and now move into the environment where she would have been restricted and go for what was hers, and to make sure that she got and held the garment of Christ, she was now made whole because her heart had the courage to believe, "If I just touch the hem of his garment, everything is going to be all right." Can we remember Matthew 14 and 27, where Jesus was told his disciples to just go on in the boat, "I'll meet you over there." And Jesus comes walking on the water, and his disciples are panicking because it looks like their master, but they've never seen anybody defy gravity. They've never seen anybody walk on water, and they were wondering if it's a ghost. And the word that came from Jesus was, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. I speak to you that feels like life is swallowing you up. I speak to you who feels like you're afraid of the things that you see coming at you. I want you to know that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." It doesn't matter what's happening in society. It doesn't matter how many people are unemployed. It doesn't matter if your job is laying off people. It doesn't matter if your bank account is running low. It doesn't matter if your marriage is in trouble. It doesn't matter if COVID is wreaking havoc and we have a whole bunch of things happening that's changing up society. I want to challenge you today, and the word of the Lord is today, you got to learn how to take heart. I challenge you to keep your chin up. I challenge you not to flinch in the midst of adversity. I challenge you to stand strong and stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. For the Lord is great. He is mighty. He's the Lord God of an army, and there is nothing that can happen to you that escapes his awareness. My word to you today is, don't flinch, ladies and gentlemen. Don't flinch, brothers and sisters. You got to learn how to take heart and be of good courage, for the Lord will strengthen your heart today for all the hell that's going on around you. If you can't get anything today, I dare you to put your chin up in the midst of all the confusion, in the midst of all the hurt, in the midst of all the pain. Don't you hang your head. Don't you lay down and cry. I want you to stand up on your feet and stand with the affirmation and the strength of the Lord, and don't you be discouraged. Hold your chin up high and take heart, because God is in control. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so when we look at our text for today, we see here that Jesus has a dialogue, a discussion with his disciples. When he looks at his disciples, he begins to talk to them about things that are closing in. Gospel of John is interesting because Jesus is portrayed here as the Son of God, and he's revealing himself as the Son of God. John begins his gospel by really pointing out the contrast between darkness and light. The world is described as darkness in the Gospel of John, and as the blackness of a dark abyss that the prince of this world has control of. But there is the light that has come into the world, and his name is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the world that we see is a world that is void of the presence of light. But the God of the universe comes to shine light into this sphere. And he that knew no sin became sin. And he now was able to capture the very things that had us bound. And we saw all of this happen in the scriptures. And there's a process where he is going through and he's beginning to tell them of this journey that he's about to take in order to conquer the darkness once and for all. And so he tells them in the scripture, he tells them as we read today, in this world you will have trouble. He says, in this world you will have tribulation, but take heart. Take heart because I have overcome the world. Hallelujah. 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 He has overcome. He has overcome the world. Bless the name of the Lord. So behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come, he tells them, where you will be scattered. Each one is going to go to his own home and you will leave me alone. Yet I want you to understand that I am not alone. I may be lonely, but I'm not alone. See, sometimes you may be a little lonely because you feel like there's nobody else around you. But I want you to know if you have God in your life, then you are never alone. And if that is the truth, if you're never alone, then really and truly, you should never be lonely. I speak to those who are in isolation. I speak to those who are still working at home and not around the atmosphere where you have other people around as normal pre-pandemic, but you're in a situation where you feel like you're losing your mind and you feel like the things are closing in on you and you feel isolated. Well, I speak to you today because one plus God is a majority. And if you learn to just lean on the everlasting arms of your God and your King, you'll begin to realize I'm not alone. Therefore, I cannot be lonely. And even though I may feel like I'm lonely, I'm never alone because my God is with me. And so he begins to talk to them about some things. He says, now, as I take you back to verse 16, he tells them in a little while. He says, in a little while, you will see me no longer. Now, he's walking with them for about three years, and now they've spent every day with him. They've walked with him. They've talked with him. He has ministered to them. They have had wonderful times together. They've seen some phenomenal things happen together. But he now is telling them that he's about to step off of the scene. And he says, in a little while, you will see me no longer. And again, in a little while, you will see me. So in other words, he is now speaking of his death, his burial, and the resurrection. So some of the disciples said to one another, verse 17, what is this that he says to us? A little while you will not see me, and again, a little while you will see me, and because I'm going to the Father. So they were saying, what does he mean by a little while? And we don't know, we do not know what he is talking about, the disciple says, because Jesus was now speaking figuratively, but he was really trying to help them understand the death, burial, and the resurrection. So Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said, like a strong teacher, you can sense the questions that are about to come, and he said, what I meant by saying, a little while you will see me and not see me, and again, a little while you will see me, he says, truly, truly, I will say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. He says, you will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn to joy. When a woman is given birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also, you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you ever again. And he says in verse 23, in that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be filled. Then he goes over to 25. He says, I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. And in that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you. Now you will have a relationship yourself, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. And so I came from the Father and have come into the world. And now I am leaving the world and going to the Father. And his disciples finally got it. And they said, ah, now you are speaking plainly. First you're talking about in a little while you're going to be here. And then in a little while you'll be gone. And then a little while you'll be back. And Jesus, can you just talk to us plainly? And so Jesus helped them understand, I'm going, leaving this world and going to be with my Father. And now they say, ah, okay. Now you're talking our language, Jesus. All this parable stuff, you got us all tripped up here. Just give it to us straight. And he said, now you're speaking plainly, not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God. And Jesus now says to them, do you now believe? He says, oh, so you got it now? Oh, you get what I've been saying? And so behold, the hour is come. Now that you get it, now I can talk to you about that it's here. The time has come now. Indeed, it is here where you will be scattered. And you will go to your own home, and you will leave me, because now the Son of Man has to be handed over. And so he says, I want you to understand that while it may look like you leave me alone, I want you to know that I'm never alone and I'm never lonely. Why? For my Father is with me. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but I want you to take heart, because I've overcome the world. In other words, Jesus is saying to his disciples, he said, listen, I know that this is going to mess with you a little bit. And I'm telling you that at some point in time, you've been walking with me for these 3 years, but at some point in time, you will leave me too. It has to happen that way. You will walk away. You will be in a place that appears like it's dark, like your friend, your master, your everything has now left you. And now what do I do? If you're in that place where it feels like so much that you had going on for you, it was happening and going so well, but those things that were going on for you, maybe it's in the midst of the pandemic, maybe it's before the pandemic began, things started to move away from you, and now you feel like you're isolated, now you feel like you're alone. Maybe there was a relationship you had and you found comfort in it, but then it left you, and now you feel like you are in a place where nobody understands and nobody can really is there for you when you really need them to be there. I want you to take courage, and I want you to find peace in the scripture today. Jesus is saying there's going to be situations where people will come against you, but I've already told you if the world hates you, understand that they already hated me first. But I want you to know I'm giving you something that's great. I'm giving you a divine connection with the Father, and the way that you get the divine connection with the Father that gives me the peace to feel like I have somebody with me, even when nobody is physically around me, I'm giving that to you. And the way that you get it is that you believe that I am, the one that he has sent. See, when you have Jesus in your heart, what happens is the Spirit of God comes into your heart. So no matter if nobody is around you, you still have somebody on the inside that's greater than anybody that can be with you on the outside. And so you got to learn how to have peace in the midst of all that's going on around you. And you may think you need all of these people to help bring comfort, but the greatest person you need is deep down on the inside of you. And if nobody is with you, you need to learn how to hold your head high. You need to have your chin up, and you need to learn how to take heart, because it doesn't matter how many people are coming against you. He says, I'm going to give you peace if you learn just how to take heart. Why? Because I have overcome the world. He says, hold on to your faith. faith is the victory that overcomes the world today. Hold on to your faith in the midst of the storm, because in a little while, it's going to be all over. I want you to know the troubles of this world, they don't last always. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy is going to come in the morning light. I want you to know that God's wrath is even for a moment, but his favor is for a lifetime. I don't know what you're going through right now. I don't know why you ended up on this broadcast, but I hear the Spirit of God speaking directly to you. There's some things that you've been holding your hand. There's some things that have been happening to you psychologically and emotionally, and it's been messing you up. You've been crying at night. You feel alone. You feel empty. You feel like you don't even know if God is with you. But if you believe in the Son of God and you've confessed him as the Lord and the Savior of your life, I want you to know that he that is with you is greater than all of the world against you. I want you to learn that no matter what circumstance you're in, wherever you find yourself, I want you to know that God is greater. He's with you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. You need to learn how to take heart today, ladies and gentlemen. Hold your head up high. Hold your chin up and get heart in this thing and wait on the Lord and be of good courage, because while this world may be waxing worse and worse, I want you to know that in a little while, we're going home. This thing is not going to last forever. And while it looks like all hell is breaking loose and it might consume you, I want you to be encouraged. As the scripture says, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I wouldn't have told you that. I go to prepare a place for you. And when I go to prepare a place to you, I will come again and lead you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I want you to hold on, brothers and sisters, because in a little while, mansions that have been prepared, rooms that have been prepared by the great carpenter himself, he says, I'm coming back. And I want you to know that in a little while, we are going home. Hallelujah. There's an old hymn that I used to sing in my old church growing up as a little boy. We didn't sing most of the contemporary songs, and I have nothing against the contemporary songs. They're wonderful tunes. But sometimes they lack the lyrical essence and the vitality that is needed to touch my soul. And I thank God for my parents bringing me up in certain traditions that even though there were other things that I did not like, there's some other things that stuck with me. And the old hymns of Zion, there's a hymn that was written. It says, in a little while, we're going home. Let us sing a song that will cheer us by the way. In a little while, we are going home. For the night will end in the everlasting day. In a little while, we are going home. In a little while, in a little while, we shall cross the billows foam. We shall meet at last when the stormy winds are past. In a little while, we are going home. Last verse says, there's a rest beyond. There's relief from every care. In a little while, we're going home, and no tears shall fall in the city bright and fair, for in a little while, we're going home. Ladies and gentlemen, in a little while, we shall cross the billows foam. We shall meet at last when the stormy winds are past. Whatever's going on in your life, whatever storms are coming your way, I want you to be of good courage, ladies and gentlemen, because in a little while, it's going to be over. All the troubles of this world, it's going to be over. Sooner we'll be done with the troubles of this world. You're going to go home and be with the Lord. Until then, take courage. Until then, hold on. Until then, fight the good fight of faith. Until then, when life starts throwing punches at you, hold your head up high. Hold your chin up high, because in a little while, it's going to be all over. Take heart, ladies and gentlemen, because he that died on that cross got up with power, and that same power that raised Christ from the dead, it has the ability to empower you to do every good work and meet up against every odd that comes against you. Greater is he that is within you than he that is in the world. I want you to take heart. I want you to take heart and give God the glory and the praise. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. 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 In a little while. In a little while. In a little while. In a little while. Take heart, ladies and gentlemen. For in a little while, Just a little while. Whatever you're going through, tell yourself, this not going to last. This not going to last. This not going to last. This is a light affliction. This not going to last. This not going to take me out either. In a little while. In a little while. Ah, I feel someone's strength coming on as I feel my own coming on in a little while. Wherever you are, I know it hurts right now. I know it looks like the skies are dark and it looks gloomy and doesn't look like you're going to make it out. But in a little while, take heart, ladies and gentlemen. God will see you through. How do I know that he'll see you through? Because he's already made a promise. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. God is greater than anyone and anything. There's nothing that could come against you. We bind every attack of the enemy. We bind everything that comes to bring fear, doubt, and confusion in a little while. Yes, there may be some times where you may feel isolated and feel alone, but just know he has already overcome the world. Is COVID going to take me out? Is this pandemic going to destroy my business? Will I ever recover? Yes, you will. Take heart, for in a little while, just a little while, every day, you need to get up and tell yourself, any day now, God will do just what he said he will do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, I want you to just take your communion elements. Let's go to communion. Let not your heart be troubled. All kinds of things are happening around you. Jesus says this in the midst of Judas betraying him and all of these things. And you're looking around and you're saying, what is going on? He said, it's all right. It's a part of the plan. He says, now, may get a little rocky, but take on my peace. For in a little while. At night, he took the bread with them to let them know what was about to go down. Took that bread, he said, this is my body that is broken for you. He said, when you eat this, I want you to remember that I'll be wounded for your transgressions. I'll be bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement of your peace be upon me. By my stripes, you will be healed. As you eat this today, I want you to rest in the assurance of everything that the Word of God says and the promise that he's made and everything that was secured by his body being beaten, torn, just for you. It's what allows us to be unified in the body. It's what allows us to be accepted in the beloved. Today, when you eat, in remembrance of him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's right, minister. It may get a little rocky. But if you take God's peace, it's going to be all right. Hallelujah. On the same night he took the cup, he blessed it, said, this is the cup of the new covenant. He says, this is the cup that represents my blood for the remission of sins. I want you to know that this is for sins past, present, and future. Yes, God. Everything you've ever done, everything you're doing right now, everything that you will do, he says, I'm making provisions. I want you to know that this is a symbol of the love and the grace and the mercy of God. This is what allows you to realize that you're never alone. No matter how distant you feel from God, no matter how much you feel like you may have disappointed God, he knew that the disciples might have fallen into a place of disappointment when they left him alone. But he wanted them to know that it's okay. Things have to happen. But I'm going to be all right. And guess what? You're going to be all right too. Whatever's going on with you, take assurance in the blood that covers and that has given you
a place in eternity. Hold on. Don't ever let this go. Don't ever take it for granted. When you drink this today, think about the forgiveness that God has placed over your life, no matter what. He loves you no matter what you've done, no matter where you've gone, or even if you've had moments where you have separated yourself from Him. You're still here. You're still standing. And He says, my blood still covers you. Forgiveness is yours. Forgiveness is anyone's who repents. Today, Lord, we repent of everything that has violated you. We thank you for your forgiveness and your blood. Now, God, may we, as we have been forgiven, may we learn to forgive others. In Jesus' name. Drink now in remembrance of his blood shed for you and I. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, God. Yes, God. Let the revival come into your soul. Whatever's going on, just block it out. Block it out. Block out the troubles of this world. Block out the issues. Block out the problems. Let God revive your soul. Right now, just take a moment to just worship him and magnify him and thank him. Thank him for this word that gave you the ability to hold on just another day and the day after that and the week after that and the month after that. As long as he tarries, you got to know that he is with you. Take heart. Wait on the Lord. No matter who's coming against you, what the world is coming against you, he's already overcome the world. And no weapon formed against you shall prosper. In Jesus' name. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Hallelujah. 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 God, bring about healing and restoration for every lonely heart, God. Strengthen them right now in the name of Jesus. For every person that is doubting if they're going to make it through, the devil is a liar. Don't you listen to him. You will make it. Even if nobody else is with you, the Spirit of God is in you. One plus God is a majority. You will make it. When you're going to get your breakthrough, I can't tell you when. All I know is in a little while. In a little while, God will do just what he said he will do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I've been refreshed today. Take heart, ladies and gentlemen. Don't let anybody take your heart. Take heart. Don't let anybody make you fearful and discouraged. Take heart. Stand and see the salvation of the Lord. Well, we thank you so much for being with us today. Honor and privilege was mine to host you for this worship experience. We hope that you were blessed. We hope that you were lifted up. You felt the presence of God speaking to your heart and empowering you today. We praise God for your presence, those who have been visiting and streaming in with us. God bless you. We apologize for any technical difficulties that might been there, but we thank God we were able to press our way through. Hallelujah. We thank God that we are still here. And so I want to take up today's offering. Those of you that would like to give a blessing to God, show your gratitude. I always believe that worship is not complete without offering. In fact, giving an offering is an act of worship. And so we do this as the men of old, when they had an encounter with Jesus or God himself, they would actually erect an altar and they would lay an offering on it to show their gratitude. One, to just signify, man, there's no way I should have had an audience with God, because to see God and to have an audience with God, as sinful as we are, is to deserve death. But this offering as a sacrifice is now my substitutionary death that should have come my way, but it also signified the great substitutionary death in the Lamb of God that will die for the sins of the entire world. And so we thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ. And now we give him the offerings and the sacrifices of praise, which is also the fruit of our lips. And out of gratitude, we give offerings to him, knowing that they will come back to us, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Today, if you would like to give unto the Lord, I want you to get your mobile phones, and I want you to text the word Reflections Give. Reflections Give to 77977. Reflections Give to 77977. Those of you with international phone numbers, non-U.S. numbers, you can go on pushpay.com. You can follow the prompts there, Reflections Church BK, and you can give there as well. We thank God for all of the givers, those that continue to support ministry. You help keep us afloat. We praise God for you. We pray that we'll continue to give you even greater programming where that can feed your spiritual lives. We thank God for those of you that continue to sow continuously, even in the middle of the week. People are just thinking about ministry and also making sure that we are able to sustain. And we thank God for your generosity. Thank you for being on our broadcast. Thank you for those who shared the broadcast with others. We pray that people have been blessed today. If you don't have a home church, and you'd like to find out how you can be a part, put something in the chat, send us a message, or you can connect with us on our email at churchofreflectionsbk.org. Or you can now text us at 347-762-5222, 347-762-5222. That's our WhatsApp number. If you have a praise report, if you have a video that you would like to submit to just show the praise, a praise report of what God has done, share it with us. We'll be happy. See if we can put it on the broadcast and share it with the world as well, if you like. So thank you so much. Then also, want to remind everybody, we are online Sundays at 11 and Wednesdays at 7:30. You can connect with us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and, of course, our WhatsApp number. You can text us, send us a video message if you like. If you'd like to join the ministry, text us there as well. We'll be sure to get in contact with you. Also, on Tuesday, we're back. We are back, 6 a.m. Tuesday morning prayers. I'll be here praying for you and praying for the congregation. You know, prayer is powerful. We believe in the power of prayer. If you have any prayer requests, send it to that WhatsApp number, 347-762-5222, and be sure to lift you up in prayer. Then Wednesday, back to see you for 7:30. We praise God for those who have been tuning in for our Kingdom of God series. We had a powerful time last week. We praise God for continued growth and understanding of his word. Listen, we have a few more weeks to collect the census. And brethren, we're behind in Brooklyn. A lot of people have been scared to do the census. We have a lot of immigrants here. And the powers that be have done a good number in trying to scare people from taking that census. But I want you to understand how important the census is. It's extremely important because that's about resources that come to the community to help sustain us. And so this is only done every 10 years. And it is also about the representation that we'll have in the House of Representatives. And if we do not have the proper count, we will lose delegates, and that means less representation, especially for a borough that has so many people that need to be served. And so let's do our best. I know many of us here at Reflections have already completed it, but I want you to call to 10 people, man. We got to be on a crusade because we got to get our numbers up, or else Brooklyn is going to be underserved.
And when we are underserved, that's less resources. And when people have less resources, it's all connected to a number of things, which is also violence and crime. So let's do our part. Let's be on the crusade. Let's make Brooklyn count 100%. Praise God. Thank you for connecting with us. Let's look to the Lord to be dismissed. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its power. We thank you for speaking to our hearts. We thank you for reviving us today. We thank you that in you we can take heart. We know that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up in judgment shall be condemned. I speak it now over every life that is here under the sound of my voice. Cover your people and bless them and keep them. Make your face to shine upon them. And thank you, God, that we have your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you again Tuesday morning, corporate prayer on Facebook and YouTube. Then also Wednesday night. God bless you. I love you in Jesus' name. See you soon.